So if we have started YouTube already, I want to welcome everybody. If we haven't started YouTube yet, I'm going to do it all over again. So again, welcome to everyone joining us on YouTube for our Wednesday morning class, which again, we've never given a title to. But we're so excited to be together as we are each Wednesday. This will be the last Wednesday of the year, obviously. And so what we usually do is once we finish a subject matter, we will then decide what we'll be studying the next week or the next weeks. Today, we're doing our last of the three parts on Jewish composers, mostly of the 20th century. And so we have a special guest teacher today as Larry Rosendorf is going to teach. He's going to talk about the legend Leonard Bernstein or Bernstein. And hopefully, as I mentioned previously, he's going to explain to all of us what his last name was and how it's pronounced. So everyone, thank you, Larry. Welcome.
Let me try and share and see if this works. I know we had some difficulty. Can everybody see my desktop?
Yes, we can.
What happened?
How's the sound?
You might want to turn up your sound a little bit if you can.
Okay, I'm at max.
Okay, so everybody, if you can't hear, just turn up yours.
I'm at the max on sound now. Hopefully, it'll come in okay. I just installed a new version of Zoom, and I also put a new mouse on my computer. So I have two new things going on. I tried it about an hour ago. It seemed to work, so I'm hoping things will be okay.
Well, we see it perfectly.
So yeah, I hope everything will be good here. So the title of the talk is Bernstein, and I call it, and a few rabbit holes. Now, rabbit hole, as you probably know, is something that you go down in and it leads you into all different directions. So if you go into a rabbit hole, it leads you to some excursions that are probably pretty interesting. So you'll have to pardon me because sometimes I do go on the stream of consciousness and I get into a couple of side issues here, but I think they're interesting and I'll try and connect the dots, hopefully. So Happy New Year to everybody. Good riddance, as we already said, to 2020. If you would please, we have a lot to cover here. So I'd ask you if you could hold the questions and comments or use the chat room. And then at the end of the presentation, hopefully, we'll be able to get to the questions and comments. And if not, maybe we could even hold them over for another. And if you could stay muted, if you would please, if you could mute everybody during the talk, it would be helpful. I know a lot of times people get phone calls and things like that, and you know, just upsets the rhythm of everything. So with that said, let's kind of continue on to Lenny. And that, of course, is Lenny. And the key question that's on everybody's mind is, how do you pronounce the name? So, of course, I went to the source, and it is Leonard, if you can look across here, Bernstein. But if we say Lenny, if we say Leonard Bernstein, whatever we want to say, that'll be okay as well. And if you could read, you could see that his, you read the titles here, born in 1918 and 1990. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on his bio, but the key thing is, look at all of the things that he's done. Composer, conductor, pianist, music educator, author, lifelong humanitarian, significant American cultural personality of the 20th century. Gives you his height and weight, his children, his parents, what he was weighing. And I threw this in over here at the bottom here. I'm not going to say a heck of a lot about it, but you can go to some of the biographies or some of the talks about it. And if you wanted to summarize who he was as a person, actually, also you have to understand that he was a gay man who married. That is kind of like a quick summary. And I won't go into his other kind of relationships. There is a Netflix now is coming out with a film. I don't know the status of it. I didn't check the latest status, and maybe afterwards, if somebody knows more about it than I do, Bradley Cooper, who was in the recent film with Gaga, A Star Is Born. He's written, directed, and will star as Leonard Bernstein in a Netflix version of a Leonard Bernstein biography or part of his life. I'm not sure how much he's going to do it, so it should be interesting to see it. But there's no shortage of Leonard Bernstein information on the computer, on YouTube and on Netflix and things like that. This is a guy who was constantly in front of the cameras and constantly available, I think, for interviews. As a matter of fact, if you want to go back to the early years, I even found a dissertation that was done for a PhD thesis on his relationship between the cantor of his shul, Solomon Breslovsky. He grew up in the Boston area, I think in Lawrence, Massachusetts. And he spent his early years basically in the Massachusetts area before going to Harvard. And he was heavily, heavily influenced by this cantor, Breslovsky. Some of his biographers talk about the fact that he was truly probably the first Jewish composer, conductor, musician who really had a popular one, who had real roots in the synagogue. Many of the others that we're familiar with, you know, the George Gershwins and the Richard Rodgers, Oscar Hammerstein, were certainly Jewish, and they certainly had Jewish in their vocabulary. But Bernstein really got his Jewishness out of the synagogue. Not that he was an observant Jew all of his life, in the true sense of being ultra-Orthodox or Orthodox, but he was Jewish. So those were kind of the early years of Bernstein. I didn't read the dissertation, but I'm sure there's a lot more information about it as well. The start of Leonard Bernstein's career really came about almost accidentally on November 14th, 1943 at 3 o'clock in the afternoon when, as you could see, it says under the direction of Bruno Walter. Bruno Walter was the head conductor of the Philharmonic Symphony of New York at the time. And Walter got sick unexpectedly. And Bernstein, as an assistant conductor, was called in that morning or that afternoon to give the concert in Bernstein's name. And if this will work, let's go to the page, the Wikipedia page for a minute, and see if I can show something kind of unique here.
Good afternoon. United States Rubber Company again invites you to Carnegie Hall to hear a concert of the New York Philharmonic Symphony Orchestra, of which Arto Radzinski is musical director. Bruno Walter, who was to have conducted this afternoon, is ill, and his place will be taken by the young American-born assistant conductor of the Philharmonic Symphony, Leonard Bernstein.
Okay, so that was Bernstein's big break. That was the start of it all. An assistant conductor didn't really have a heck of a lot to do. I mean, they basically went through auditions and through rehearsals and things like that. But they were not, they always had to be prepared at the last minute, but basically they were not given the major opportunities because the big names, the Bruno Walters, Dimitri Mitropoulos, and some of the others were the people that came, that the audience came to see. Bernstein was unique in that he was American, American born, and very, very few, if any, conductors up until that time were the lead conductors of American orchestras. And here he had the opportunity to take over as the conductor and would soon become the conductor for the Metropolitan Opera, for the Philharmonic of New York. This is a very, very nice little video that I wanted to show. Let me get it on here, hopefully. Sometimes we have to go through the commercials for this. I hope we don't know.
Mando, thank you for coming.
Like to be in America. Auf den Straßen New Yorks ist dieser Song wie eh und je präsent. Sein Schöpfer und seine West Side Story immer noch eine Legende. Leonard Bernstein. Als Musiker so vielseitig wie kein anderer vor oder nach ihm.
He was the most famous classical musician, known as a conductor. He was beloved by audiences and lionized. And we have all these recordings, which are so extraordinary. We think of him as this great ambassador for classical music.
He was such an amazing communicator. He was a born teacher, and his Young People's Concerts with the New York Philharmonic on television really transformed more than one generation of music lovers in this country and around the world.
Ready? Go. Pick it up, pick it up, pick it up, bump, bump. Pick it up, pick it up, pick it up, bump, bump. You win.
You think about the people who knew him, who worked under him, who were inspired by him, thousands and thousands of people, all of whom are running around the world right now. We pay tribute to him every day we talk and do anything.
Für seine Leidenschaften ging Bernstein bis an seine Grenzen und darüber hinaus. Die Welt liebte ihn dafür und wusste doch nicht um den Kampf, den er vor allem darum führte, als Komponist ernst genommen zu werden. In diesem Kampf liegt der Schlüssel zur Jahrhundertfigur Leonard Bernstein.
So that's from a film called The Genius Divided, which I have not seen, and I will try to see the entire thing. And if I find it, I'll send out the link for everybody if it is available. So it looks like a really, really fine film delving into, really what the genius is of Leonard Bernstein and the complexity of the man. Let's go to Lenny's birthday party.
Lenny, in honor of your 70th birthday, Stephen Sondheim has written a song just for you. It's called The Saga of Lenny, accompanied by Paul Ford. Please welcome Miss Lauren Bacall.
Just a word here. This was on his 70th birthday, as they said. You'll hear the music actually is from one of Kurt Weill's opera, and you'll hear him say, in the poem that, or in the song that she sings, she'll make mention of Weill, but it's a very, very, very clever lyric in this. So let me play.
There once was a boy named Lenny, whose talents were varied and many, so many that he was inclined never to make up his mind. In fact, he was so gifted, he seldom felt uplifted, just undefined. Poor Lenny, 10 gifts too many, the curse of being versatile. To show how bad the curse is, we'll need a lot of verses and take a little vial. Lenny made his mind up when he was 3. He'd write a show, a ballet, and a symphony. But once the winds were tootled and the first strings plucked, he decided it was terrible, he'd have to conduct. Poor Lenny, time and again he complained, "I'm in this dreadful bind. I feel for Leonardo. God, genius is so hard. Oh, you cannot make up your mind." Lenny made his mind up when he was 9. He'd be not only Bernstein, he'd be Rubenstein. But just Rubenstein, he grumbled, "That's like calling it quits when there's Hammerstein and Wittgenstein and Gertrude and Blitz." Poor Lenny knew there and then he might easily get oversteined. From Ein to Epp to Julie to Liechtenstein. No, truly, he could not make up his mind. Mm-hmm. Lenny made his mind up at 22 to do whatever Pinsa or Astaire could do. Though his voice was truly bass, he had the charm of a kid. And if the dance floor didn't suit him, the podium did. Poor Lenny, wondering when he could show off all his gifts combined, began a TV feature. It's best to be a teacher when you can't make up your mind. Lenny made his mind up at 28 that marriage and a family would be just great. But he had no time for weddings till the great day came. He was free between a tennis and an anagrams game. Poor Lenny, worse though, poor Jenny, who muttered all those years, resigned. I don't care if he picks a schlamozzle or a schickser, he should please make up his mind. Lenny made his mind up at 46 that maybe atonality and rock would mix. Though it certainly was cereal with rhythm on top, it had lots of snap and crackle, but not enough pop. Poor Lenny, pacing his journey, was worried he'd be left behind. He mumbled, how ironic, atonal is a tonic when you can't make up your mind. So is minimalism. Lenny made his mind up at 70 to be a modern Renaissance-like man, you know. And there's virtually nothing that he hasn't done. So get ready for his club act at 71. Poet, pundit, seer, politician, skier, still at sea at 70. Decked with every laural, Lenny, here's the moral. Do whatever pleases you and when. Follow all your talents, don't attempt to balance. Shower us with every kind. Share your every vision, stick with indecision. Don't make up, you shouldn't make up, you mustn't make up, don't ever make up. Live another score, write another score, and don't make up your mind.
So maybe you can do it all. Maybe you can be a man of all seasons, so to speak, and you don't have to specialize. But if you have a talent like Lenny, now you really know you've arrived if you've been sketched by Al Hirschfeld. And Hirschfeld is known as a pun on the Lion King, the Lion King. And here you see some of his line drawings of Leonard Bernstein. But his most famous line drawing, of course, is the one of Star Trek. And that's the one that we must show every time that we do a presentation, because the rabbi insists upon at least some nod to Star Trek. So this is the nod. I hope the rabbi got this. Okay, let's look a little bit about Lenny and his teaching. And many of these are in his own words.
And what have teachers got to do with music? Well, the answer is everything. We can all imagine a painter who's self-taught, or a writer, but it's almost impossible to imagine a professional musician who doesn't owe something to one teacher or another.
Very strange thing that lernen in German, which means to learn, and lehren, to teach, derive from the same place and are almost the same word. And in fact, there are dialects of German, including Yiddish, by the way, in which a lerner means a teacher. And there's a provincialism in American speech, whereby you say, I'll learn you, that'll learn you, meaning that'll teach you. So that you see they are interchangeable words, basically, deep down. So when I teach, I learn. When I learn, I teach. Play at sea.
We could literally spend an entire program on any one of the many aspects of Bernstein's talent. I'm trying to give a very, very brief overview here of all of his talents. But if you go to YouTube, which is an amazing source, you can literally find YouTube videos of many, if not all, of his omnibus recordings, which he did in the 50s, his Young People's Concerts on just about every subject that you could think of, things like humor in music, Beethoven, jazz, rock music, a tribute to Aaron Copland, Latin music, and so forth, and I encourage you to go to those. But some of the most insightful things that we could find about Bernstein, I go back and forth, are some of the things that he said in his own words. A liberal man or woman or child is a person who looks forward to a better day, a more tranquil night, and a bright infinite future. To achieve great things, two things are needed, a plan and not quite enough time. You have to be under some kind of a time pressure. Music can name the unnameable and communicate the unknowable. Inspiration, as wonderful as it is, the writer has to develop an approach for the rest of the time when you don't have inspiration. And because the wait is simply too long to get the inspiration, you really have to work at it. I've been all over the world and I've never seen a statue of a critic. And there's many, many others. Life without music is unthinkable. Life without music is academic. That is why my contact with music is a total embrace. One of his saddest comments is this one: the 20th century has been a badly written drama from the beginning, the opposite of a Greek drama. Act one, greed and hypocrisy leading to a genocidal world war, a boom, a crash, a totalitarianism. Act two, greed and hypocrisy leading to a genocidal war, a boom, a crash, totalitarianism. Act three, I dare not continue. So he had a lot of pessimism in him. And in a lot of his music and in a lot of his productions, you do see the pessimism. These are a list of some of the compositions that I was able to find, and there are probably others as well, which had Jewish content in it. And I did want to spend a little bit of time on, the arrows got mixed up somehow, but on the Hashkivenu and the Hallel first, and then go into a couple of the others. Hashkivenu is particularly interesting, and maybe the rabbi can give us some insight into Hashkivenu afterwards, but that is kind of like the prayer that we said at the Maariv service. He was commissioned in 1945 to write a prayer or write something for the synagogue by one of the most famous cantors at that time, a guy named David Putterman, who was a cantor at the Park Avenue Synagogue. And Putterman basically, from the years 1943 to 1970, you can find a listing, and there's articles that are written about the whole spectrum of musicians that he asked to come over and to write orchestral pieces or synagogue pieces for the Park Avenue Synagogue. Some of which were more famous than others. And it probably would be interesting to go back and to look at it. Putterman eventually became into some sort of disrepute, and they took his name off a lot of this because of some allegations against him, which were, I think, later substantiated. But let's listen a little bit to the Hashkivenu. This is really a prayer for protection. It's let us lay us down, O Lord, raise us up to life, spread over us the tabernacle of peace, shield us, shelter us, guard our coming in and our coming out always. Let's hear what Leonard Bernstein's sounds like. This is a marvelous chant, by the way. in his music, and here he uses a little bit. I'll try and get to the right spot where he uses the call and response. And there are many, many versions of it. I think that cant is particularly very good. Ozzy Schwartz at the Park Avenue Synagogue. That was done quite a few years. It's a much more recent version of it. The second piece that I wanted to go to was almost the last thing that he had written, which is called Halil. And Halil in Hebrew means flute. And he wrote this in commemoration of a fellow named Yadin Tannenbaum, who he did not know. And he said, I know his spirit. And Yadin was killed in the Yom Kippur War. And this is several years after the Yom Kippur War that he wrote this. And Yadin was a flutist. And what he tries to show here, I think, is the beauty of a flutist who is caught up in the midst of all of the violence of the war. And I think you'll see this a little bit in the presentation, where you have a solo flutist now in the middle of the orchestra, and he's trying to create a melody, and then he has all of this atonal music that is surrounding him. Several years after that, Bernstein was approached by a Holocaust survivor, and he said this would make a marvelous program also for the Holocaust survivors. And Bernstein agreed, and nowadays you can find versions of this where it's narrated at the very beginning with a Holocaust survivor talking about it. So this is a little bit of Halil, the flute solo, and then with the discordant orchestra coming in at the end or toward the middle. interest of time, because we have a lot to go through here, but you can hear the struggle of the flute is trying to maintain its melody and its beauty over the discordance of what seems to be the horrors of war. A prayer that we're all familiar with, Yigdal, sung at the evening services, the Shabbat evening service. He took this particular prayer. The Yigdal is based on Maimonides' 13 principles of faith. And this would be an interesting topic in itself to talk about. And what I've done is I've just selected a few of the 13 principles. I know we say the Yigdal and we sing it as an acrostic, and I never really pay that much attention to the words. Some of them are kind of interesting. Principle number 5, for example, no intermediaries, pray directly to gods. The prophets and prophecy exists. Moses was the greatest of all the prophets. The Torah should never be added to, subtracted to, abridged, or changed in any way. God rewards those who command, who obey the Torah. The days of the Messiah will come and the dead will be resurrected, was principle 13. So it would be an interesting subtopic. Another one of these rabbit holes to kind of go through is, and maybe we could do that at a future time, is look at the 13 principles of Maimonides. So here's a little bit of Yigdal. And piano or Chinese. Well, this is done in Hong Kong, and it just goes to show the universality of Bernstein's music. I mean, this was a Hong Kong church group, apparently, that had done this performance that was videoed. Moving on a little bit, in 1963, Bernstein returned to some of the Jewish motifs and something that he was inspired by, if the word inspired is correct, of President John Kennedy, assassination of Kennedy. He was quite despondent at the time, obviously, in which he had thought that God was on the verge of self-destruction here. He had written what was called the Kaddish Symphony, or the Third Symphony. Now, a symphony in Bernstein's eyes is not the same as a classical symphony that you think of, like Mozart or Beethoven or Brahms, which had four basic movements that were sort of dictated by the style. And generally, they were in the same key with variations. One was a slow movement or a fast movement. Bernstein has his three symphonies that he wrote, totally different. They're all choral. He wrote the ending. He wrote this as an explanation, and he gave this as a talk one time, I think, in Madison Square Garden. We musicians, like everyone else, are numb with sorrow at this murder, Kennedy's murder, and with rage at the senselessness of the crime. But this sorrow and rage will not inflame us to seek retribution. Rather, they will inflame our art, Bernstein told the crowd. Our music will never again be quite the same. This will be our reply to violence, to make music more intensely, more beautifully, more devotedly than ever before. I don't have anything that I wanted to play of of the Kaddish here in the interest of time, but this is not the usual Kaddish. He begins in the invocation, which is the first of the three movements, where he's asking God, are you listening to us? Are you hearing? And he says he questions God, why are you allowing such disorder in mankind? He does end up with a reminder to God that God should keep in mind that he made this covenant with the Jewish people, and that that covenant should still be uppermost in his mind and in the mind of the Jewish people. He didn't understand the punishment for Kaddish. Kaddish is a troubling prayer for many of us, I think. You know, we don't understand it, and something we can, you know, do on an individual basis of praising God at the time of all of our grief. Bernstein then went on a sabbatical, and an interesting thing happened. He was trying to compose, and as I said in one of the earlier videos, he always wanted to be known as, a multi-talented person, but I think composing was really his forte, and he wanted his compositions to be taken seriously. And he gets a letter from, he's on the sabbatical, and it's around 1963 as well, and he gets this letter from Chichester in England, and organist and choirmaster there said, I'm very anxious to have something written for a piece of music for a combined choir for a festival that we're doing in 1965, which is about a year or two in the future there. And he says, I hope this isn't presumptuous, but maybe you could write something for us. And Bernstein writes back to him saying, he's writing to Bernstein again saying, here's what our choir is. It's 70 to 75 people, all boys and men. And he says, write anything you want, don't really inhibit it. But he says, it would be good if you could put something about West Side Story into your music here for us. And Bernstein writes back about a year or so later saying, you know, I'm on the verge of telling you that I really didn't have the inspiration or the time or wasn't feeling like doing it. And then it hit on me to do this concert about a suite of psalms. He says the music is very forthright. It's songful, it's rhythmic, it's youthful. And he says the only hitch is that these songs have to be sung in the original Hebrew. He says, that's the only way I can envision them. And he writes back saying, I'm pleased with the work now, and I hope you will be too. It's got an old-fashioned sweetness, and it has some violent moments. And there are many, many, many recordings of the Chichester Psalms that are out there now. It's probably Psalms. It's probably his one of his most famous choral works, not necessarily intended for the synagogue. So this led me on another rabbit hole as to what are these psalms? You know, I never really paid much attention to the Book of Psalms. So I did a little research. And again, it's another topic that possibly we can go back and do a study session on. But this rabbit hole, it's in the Jewish Bible. It's not part of the Torah, and it's not part of the prophets, but it's part of what's called the writing section. And it comes from the Greek, which is called psalmoi, which are instrumental music. In total, we have 150 psalms in our Book of Psalms, and it's divided into five books, coincidentally, like the five books of the Torah. But if you go from Bible to Bible, it's in many Bibles, including many, many Christian Bibles, the numbers are inconsistent. So if you looked at Psalm number 100 in our Bible, it might not be the same as Psalm number 100 in another Bible. The general themes are hymns of praise, royalty, particularly to King David, hymns of thanksgiving, not our Thanksgiving holiday with the pilgrims, but Thanksgiving, a lot of hymns and psalms about lament, and a lot about wisdom. And I would add two more to these as I was reading them, and some of them glancing over them. Many of them question faith. Many of them are, why is this happening to us, God? Why are we constantly being punished? And a lot of them deal with revenge on the enemies. Now, Bernstein was not the first one to use psalms. Psalms have been used by many, many, many composers, including some famous ones like Johannes Bach, Brahms, Liszt, Saint-Saëns, and many, many others. And the reason, I think, is that it's a great opportunity for the composers, because when you look at some of the words in there, there's a tremendous amount of descriptive metaphors in there. There's imagery that I think a person who can then take that imagery and change it into music. 116 of the Psalms actually have titles to them, and 40 of them have some sort of musical directions. And the musical directions are kind of in the sense of cantillations. And people for years have been trying to decode these Psalms and say, what does that music really sound like? And I think so far it's been questionable. We use it in our liturgy, we use it in holidays, we use it in events in different parts of the different sects of Judaism, say it weekly, they say the entire Psalms over 1 month. People have been trying to also say, is there some sort of an order to these Psalms? Is there some sort of a structure, a macro structure overall to the 150 Psalms? Do they tell really a story? Again, you can kind of piece together almost any story that you want. They seem to have been composed after the Babylonian exile, and generally they've been attributed to 10 authors, and David seemed to have gotten the most of all of the authors, 73 of those Psalms. So it's quite an interesting subject for Bernstein or for anybody else to have picked up. Now, what Bernstein does is kind of interesting, because what he does is he picks six Psalms. But he doesn't pick six complete Psalms. He picks bits and pieces of one, and then he interposes that with the complete Psalm. So for example, in movement number one, it's three movements in his symphony, or his Chichester Psalms, which is sort of like a symphony. He uses the second verse of Psalm 108, and then he plays the complete, he uses the complete Psalm 100. Then he goes on to Psalm 23, which is the one that we know famously is the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. And he goes into Psalm 1 through 4 verses, and finally he ends with 131, and he ends with 133, which is the one about how wonderful it would be for... Behold how good and pleasant for brethren to dwell together in unity. So he goes through kind of like the beginning of the Psalms, where he Psalm 108, which is an invocation for people to go out and sing the praises of God. He actually goes through Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. That one I'll play a little bit of, is I'll try and play a little bit of each of the sections here. Surely goodness and mercy, you know that part, and the Lord is my shepherd. Interesting thing that I read is that many of the school children in England misinterpreted that. Instead of saying surely goodness and mercy, they read it as surely good Mrs. Murphy will follow me all the days of my life. And that became almost like the first, like they do on the internet when something becomes like, rapidly flowing on the internet. But this was years and years ago. So surely goodness is Murphy. Something unusual also is that coming across this and looking at and I did this when I looked at the Book of the Maccabees, which I found there were so many different versions of the book. I found something that Thomas Jefferson had done, which is kind of similar to what I guess we all do anyway, is that Jefferson took his Bible and he actually cut it up and he created his own Bible called the Jefferson Bible, which he just put in the pieces that he felt were the most relevant to his kind of philosophy. So he kind of cut and chose the different pieces. And that's, I think, what Bernstein has done with the Psalms, is he's cut and pasted and collected the Psalms. The part from West Side Story that he included is in the second part, where after David's Psalm, Psalm 23, he comes in here with these words, make a mess of them. Make the sons of bitches pay, make a mess of them, which is not in West Side Story, but was in one of the original drafts of West Side Story. The finale, which is the Hine Matovu, is also very beautiful. After the whole thing, after the three psalms, the third section, he now comes to the finale, and it's done in a very, very calming way. So let me see if I can get a little bit of the Chichester songs here to play. The whole piece is only about 20 minutes, and there are many, many different versions. No, this is not the one I wanted, I'm sorry. Funny, these are not the ones that I wanted that came up when I did it originally, so I apologize, but okay, so I'll only do a little bit of this one. This one is Psalm 23, and he did this for a boy or a countertenor. Now, if anybody has ever heard a countertenor, that is basically a man who has never lost his boy's voice, which is a very, very strange, unusual sound. It starts with a little bit of a flute, the harp solo here. But close your eyes, and I think you'll hear a woman sing. YouTube, and you could find, as I say, many, many versions of the Chichester Psalms, and you can hear it sung by generally boys, a few times by countertenors, and even now they do have some women that are singing this part. His intention was that it should only be sung by a boy or a countertenor, because he wanted it to be a harp and then a young boy to kind of give the impression of David's psalm, Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. And then at the even the silence here is broken again by this very atonal, fierce battle that takes place between tonal music and atonal music, which I think Bernstein was really experimenting with at the time. But it does end up with a very satisfying, very, very beautiful choral piece at the end. So it's interesting music to listen to. It's only 20 minutes long. And like I say, there are many, many fine versions of this. Bernstein was also a great poet. And at the end of, after he wrote the Psalms, I'll just read this. For hours on end, I brooded and mused on materia musicae, used and abused, on aspects of unconventionality, over the death in a time of atonality. Pieces for nattering, clucking sopranos, with squadrons of vibraphones, fleets of pianos. Played with the forearms, the fists and the Psalms, and then I came up with the Chichester Psalms. These psalms are a simple and modest affair, tonal and tuneful, and somewhat square. Certain to sicken a stout John Cager with its tonics and triads in E flat major. But there it stands, the results of my pondering, 2 long months of avant-garde wandering. My youngest child, old-fashioned and sweet, and he stands on his own 2 tonal feet. And this was published in the New York Times. What's also very interesting, and another subject, another rabbit hole to go down to, remember I said there were 150 psalms? Well, I found a few more. in the Dead Sea Scrolls, they found some additional Psalms, which kind of make you believe that just like the Torah, when it was canonized, was put together out of certain books, and certain books went into the Apocrypha. The same thing happened with the Psalms, and the Dead Sea Scrolls shows that there are more Psalms, and I'm sure there are others that haven't even been found yet. So it was a cut and paste, pick and choose. Moving on to Leonard Bernstein and dance music, the ballet, and particularly his association with Jerome Robbins. The first association with Robbins took place when he wrote the music for the ballet Fancy Free, which later became the Broadway, which became a show for Broadway. And the last one was when he wrote the ballet called The Dybbuk. The Dybbuk is, of course, a mythical kind of person that comes to Judaism, almost like a cartoon kind of character, but it's part of the spirit. Never was a very big success, but it was revived in 2005. Very, very hard to see. I couldn't even find any YouTube videos about it. Jumping ahead to his film scores, there is a film score for the only film score that he wrote as really a film score, aside from taking the music from a Broadway show, was the music for On the Waterfront, which was nominated for an Academy Award. Of course, it had the Marlon Brando. And if you listen to the music for this, I think you will see some of the same types of music that you do find in West Side Story, some of the very dark, haunting music that ends up in a very hopeful kind of manner. And if you really are interested, you can get an entire book on that film score for West Side Story. So, let's turn to Broadway, which is probably where most of us know Leonard Bernstein from. And this is from a musical which some of you may know, some of you may have seen, called Spamalot. And Sir Lancelot.
Why go to the comfort of your own home? Have you heard?
Sir Lancelot is talking to the king and to Guinevere, and they're saying that they're thinking they were going to write a Broadway show, a musical show, and they're discussing, how to go about it.
Broadway?
Yes, sire, and we don't stand a chance there.
Why not?
Because Broadway is a very special place, filled with very special people. People who can sing and dance, often at the same time. They are a different people, a multi-talented people, a people who need people, and who are, in many ways, the luckiest people in the world. I'm sorry, sire. We don't have a chance.
But why?
Well, let me put it like this. In any great adventure, if you don't want to lose, victory depends upon the people that you choose. So listen, Arthur, darling, closely to this news. We won't succeed on Broadway if we don't have any Jews. You may have the finest sets, fill the stage with penthouse pets. You may have the loveliest costumes and best shoes. You may dance and you may sing, but I'm sorry, Arthur King, you'll hear no cheers, just lots and lots of boos. You may have butch men by the score, whom the audience adore. You may even have some animals from zoos. Though you've poles and krauts instead, you may have unleavened bread, but I tell you, you are dead if you don't have any Jews. They won't care if it's witty or everything looks pretty. They'll simply say it's shitty and refuse. Nobody will go, sir. If it's not kosher, then no show, sir. Even Goyim won't be dim enough to choose. Put on shows that make men stare with lots of girls in underwear. You may even have the finest of reviews.
You're doing great!
But the audiences won't care, sir, as long as you don't dare, sir, to open up on Broadway
if we don't have any Jews.
Actually, the show was directed by Mike Nichols, who, of course, is Jewish. And it is a tongue-in-cheek, and it is a tribute to the Jews. One of the ironies here is about Jewish composers, and we've talked about them in the past, is that so many of the hot hit shows on Broadway have been by Jews. But just getting back to Leonard Bernstein, Steinstein for a minute, his career on Broadway was from 1944 on The Town to his last show, which probably nobody has seen, 1976, which was 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. On the Town has been made into a movie. It's about three sailors that have their leave in New York, and they meet these three girls, and they go around to all the places in New York City. And the movie with Gene Kelly and I think Donald O'Connor is quite good. Not quite the same as the Broadway show. They had to take a lot of Bernstein's music out of it, and they thought it was a little bit too orchestral and a little too sophisticated. The second thing that he wrote was basically for TV, which was Peter Pan in 1950, and this predated the Mary Martin Peter Pan. And one song has become kind of a hit from that one, which is this Dance With Me song. And here you see the very young Jackie Evancho is singing it. Rosalind Russell in Jacqueline McKeever in A Wonderful Town, 1953, not to be confused with On the Town. In some of these shows, particularly in On the Town and Wonderful Town, Bernstein insisted that they have Black musicians in the pit. And I think in the last few performances, the last 8 months of performances of On the Town, they even had a musical conductor who was Black. 1956 was kind of a pivotal year and came back, and he wrote a show called Candide, which again, very few people have seen. I think it was like 70 performances. I was probably one of the few people that ever saw it. It's undergone a wide variety of changes over the years. It's been done in concert versions, and I'm going to play a little bit. As a matter of fact, I'm going to end in a little while with Candide. There was a show in between that, and then comes 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, where Bernstein collaborated with Alan J. Lerner, who you may remember is from Lerner and Lowe. And they had since parted at the time. This was 1976, the 200th anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. And this is sort of an upstairs, downstairs kind of musical in which he traces the presidents and the first ladies in the White House. And he traces the people that are the servants and slaves in the White House at the same time. And in one of the most beautiful and thoughtful kind of pieces, you can get them. There are many versions of it, but I love this one with Cynthia Erivo. And she does Take Care of the House, where I think it's Abigail Adams is talking to John, Thomas Jefferson. After Adams loses the election, he was only a one-term president, and he goes on and she's telling him, Abigail Adams is pleading with the president to take care of the house, the White House. Those are basically his contribution to Broadway. Let's see if you recognize this one.
Thank you.
that, of course, is you can't help hearing that and not thinking West Side Story, which is the one that I obviously omitted when I showed you the other thing, when I showed you the six shows of Broadway. No matter who is singing it, no matter the context of it, you go back and you think of the story. We're in the Low Country here, which leads me to Pat Conroy. And basically what Pat said, I think, is so true. The greatest words in the English language are, tell me a story. And when you look back at American musical theater, and this was actually the first talk that I ever gave at Ollie about 6 years ago, where I tried to say, what is it about American musical theater that makes hits and misses of different shows? And it turns out to me, what's a success and what's a failure, and a success being something that lives on and is repeated. We've had many great songwriters, Richard Rodgers and Lorenz Hart, for example, wrote some great songs, but you'd be hard pressed to find one of their musicals that has actually been rejuvenated and put on Broadway, maybe Pal Joey. Irving Berlin, you'd be very hard pressed. He wrote 25 musicals for Broadway. The only one that you probably would remember would be the Annie Get Your Gun musical. The same thing with Cole Porter. The same thing with many of the other great Jewish composers or non-Jewish composers. Rodgers and Hammerstein were different. I think they wrote 11 shows, of which probably about 7 or 8 of them you probably would say are pretty much standards. But generally, it is the story that that is so important that makes it. West Side Story, I think, set a new standard. It changed Broadway forever. It occurred at the time when Broadway had shows or musicals were on in the movies, things like Pajama Game, Damn Yankees, Music Man, which actually beat West Side Story that year for the Tony Award. My Fair Lady had come out. So that was what Broadway was into at the time. And when West Side Story came along, it was realism to its peak. It was something that was basically, as they say, shot from the headlines. It was a harsh realism. It was dark. It was conflict. It was raw. It brought real drama to the musical. It took a familiar subject and it threw it right in our faces. And it took the sort of the Romeo and Juliet romantic legend, and it showed how brutal it could be. Yet he does resolve itself into a beautiful part. West Side Story also did a couple of other things. Jerome Robbins, who I had mentioned earlier, was the not only the choreographer for West Side Story, he was the director. One of the first times that a choreographer was the director. So the show had a definite dance bent to it. And in the dancing, it actually moved the show along. And this was a time when dancers and singers were usually separate in a Broadway show. And what Jerome Robbins did was he put the dancers and singers together. And he and Bernstein, it also led to the first real collaboration between Bernstein and Stephen Sondheim. And it created what I consider to be the next great era in Broadway, which is the Sondheim era. Now, this is a little bit from Bernstein had never conducted West Side Story. And he was asked by Deutsche Grammophon to make a recording of West Side Story in which he could pick out the voices that he wants. And here's a little bit about Leonard Bernstein and what he considered to be the ultimate voice performance. I love that finger snapping, the tension in the music, and this is part of the documentary of the making of West Side Story, which is an hour and a half, and you can get the entire thing on YouTube. And it's Jose Carreras and Kiri T. Nawawa, who Kanawa, I can't even say her name, from Australia. They are the two leads in it. So let's just hear a little bit of.
Way back in 1949, Jerome Robbins, with whom I had worked, called me up with a terrific idea. He was wildly excited. A Broadway show based on Romeo and Juliet. I thought this was a very exciting idea. He had a notion that it should be based on street warfare in the New York slums.
Go back and do that once more. Still, all three of you.
Is that candy for you? Yes. That's how the show was born. And if you read Bernstein's book about it, he says the difficulty that he had in raising money to produce the show, because this was a show like no other show that Broadway had seen. The violence, the realism, the drama, and so forth. Obviously I can't show everything, but I do want to go to one part that I think is particularly, the whole thing is so gorgeous, but
final take of One Hand, One Heart just destroyed me. One of my children, Nina, who was sitting at the session and who is as hard-boiled as can be, and who was born when West Side Story was already 5 years old, came to the podium, broke in tears. I've never heard anything like it. And what was so great about that reaction, because I trust her reaction very much, she is never flattering for anything, but that was not meant to be flattering. She was just telling you how she felt.
It is a beautiful, beautiful recording. I wanted to end with, I usually end with West Side Story, but I do want to end with something from Candide, which I think is often overlooked. And this is the last song in Candide. Now, Candide is based on the Voltaire novel, in which at the time people were proclaiming, this is a wonderful world that we're living in. And Voltaire was more of a realist, and he was saying, no, it's not such a great place. There are all kinds of wars and things that are going on that are, you know, around the world. The two major characters go off into the world, and they do find all kinds of disasters in the world. But finally, at the end, they are united. And this is the last song in Candide, which has been revised many, many, many times. But if you see a concert version of it, I think you'll still enjoy it. Apologize for the commercials.
Kellogg's Raisin Bran Crunch. Two scoops of delicious.
We will not think noble because we are not noble. We will not live in perfect harmony because there is no such thing in this world, nor should there be. We can only promise to do our best and to live out our lives. Dear God, that is all we can promise in truth. Marry me, Cunegonde.
You have been a fool, and so have I. But come and be my wife, and let us try before we die to make some sense of life. We're neither pure nor wise nor good. We'll do the best we know. We'll build our house and chop our wood and make our garden grow, and make our garden grow.
I thought the world was sure.
questions?
Any questions?
Just beautiful, Larry.
Excellent, Larry. Very enjoyable.
That was really fabulous.
Well done.
Thanks a lot, Larry.
Beautiful, Larry.
Wonderful.
Larry, thank you from New Jersey at the beauty parlor.
Does anybody have any questions before we conclude? That was really fabulous. I think we learned not only a lot, but enjoyed every minute of it. Some really great choices of links, and of course, some really great information, as opposed to just a simple biography, really, I think, gave us a lot to think about. How many of us knew this much about Leonard Bernstein or Bernstein before this?
No, not at all.
No. No. I didn't even know he was Jewish, so I learned a lot. So thank you. That was really great. The question is, after this tremendous one, what do we want to do in 2021, especially the next Wednesday? Does anybody have any topics? It's going to be hard to top the, I'm glad we did this at the end. It was a great way to finish this year, even though the year, as we know, although our classes have been great, it's been a disappointing year overall. And so we're looking forward to a better one. Does anybody have any type of class they'd like to do for the very beginning of 2021? We can
unmute, Stuart.
Psalms, for example.
Stuart, you're on mute.
We could do the book. Oh, you mean the Book of Psalms? Is that what you said, Larry?
Yeah.
We could talk about Psalms a little bit if you want. We'll be happy to teach a little bit about that next time.
Or even the Kaddish prayer. And I think last time we were going to, we didn't get up to.
Oh, that's right. I have a list already. What am I thinking? We already talked about it.
Yeah, we were going to talk a little bit about Kol Nidre. And
I apologize. I completely forgot that we've. So what do I have? We can do Kol Nidre. I'll put Psalms on there. We talked about doing Yiddish, synagogue design. So if any of those are right.
Have we done one on important women in Judaism?
Yes.
That would be. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
We did a two-part series on that.
Right. One of the things I've come across is a relationship, but the idea that Esh Hayil, each of the paragraphs or characteristics refers to a woman primarily out of Torah, but certainly out of Tanakh. And I was wondering if that might not be an interesting.
Jewish women in the Bible, you mean?
Yeah, in the Tanakh, not in the Bible. Not contemporary, but
I'm happy to do that as well.
Yeah, you know, going back to Devorah, Yael, Bruria, and of course the matriarchs, Hannah.
Well, I'm happy to do that too. So we can do. We've got Psalms, synagogue design. These are the ones we've talked about. We could talk about. And Jewish women in the Bible, we could do that for the 4 month Saturdays in January if people want. And again, like what Larry did this time, if anybody knows or as an expert in any area and would like to teach this class, I mean, we got 52 of them around that. So certainly we'd love to take advantage. So thank you again, Larry. Next week, do we want to do Jewish women in the Bible or Psalms? Anybody have a preference?
Psalms.
All right, so we'll do Psalms next week. And so what I want all of you to do is something really simple. I think it'd be a lot easier if you memorized all 150. So by next week, you don't obviously have to do it in Hebrew, but it would be preferable if you did it in Hebrew, English, and maybe one other language. But that's and that language can be Yiddish. So thank you again, Larry. That was extraordinary. We really had a great end to the year with Larry and before that, Jeff leading two awesome classes. So I think we can give him a hand for that. And we look forward to seeing you guys next week. We're going to continue next week. We're going to do Psalms. And again, all our best. May 2021 be a not only a better year than 2020, but an incredible year, because we know saying a better year than this one is not saying much. So, so and don't forget, everybody, if you haven't yet, today and tomorrow, the last days for, oh, wait a minute. A lot of you guys aren't in Georgia. That is why you guys are not as important as than me. Until January 5th, I'm a lot more important than all of you. Just want you to know.
You bet.
My vote will never count so much, and probably it hasn't this far in my life, and it probably won't count as much in any time in the future. So, so I'm actually going to go vote right after this. So thank you again, everybody, and stay safe, really, and look forward to seeing you. If you have any questions or anything, let us know. And as for synagogue programs, next month we are going to do another drive-in service, and we will have a speaker after a Shabbat service on Saturday morning that I think will be particularly interesting. It's a friend of mine. He's an APAC regional person. He's going to talk about the peace negotiations between Israel, Saudi Arabia, Morocco, United Arab Emirates, and so many others. It is very possible we could have legitimate peace between Israel in several countries as early as next year. If this does happen, then the only countries that will not be at peace with Israel will be countries like Iran and Syria, which have obviously at this point is impossible. So it will be really interesting. I think it's also very interesting to note that because of the pandemic, because of the election issues, because of all the things going on, this peace process with Israel is barely making any news at all. You almost never hear about it unless you really search for it, which is, I think, probably for the better in many respects. It's gone really underground in many. So, again, I wish you all the best and look forward to seeing you next week and next year. So, Shana Tova, Happy New Year, and be safe and healthy, everyone. And thank you again, Larry. That was awesome.